this guitar sounds great and it plays good, but I want it to play great. And there's two more guitars with some issues that I can easily fix. I want my guitars in their best shape, and I guess you feel the same about your guitar. So here's my 5-step foolproof method of setting up guitars at home so they play and sound like a dream. But beware, what we're about to do is extremely dangerous and can seriously damage the... It's not dangerous at all. Everyone can do this with very little tools even. And the best of it all, it's free. For this video, I'm assuming your guitar has no major structural flaws like tormented necks, cracks or other weird issues. And if so, it may still very well be safe, but I should just bring it to a luthier instead.
You're okay?
Other than that, let's get started. And we're gonna have a look at this Novo Ceres. The first thing I noticed was that the action was a little bit too high for my own preference. I like it low. So the action is the distance measured from the bottom of the string to the top of the fret. And for this generally goes the lower, the easier it is to play. But when you get too low, the worse it'll sound. Notes will sustain less long, notes can fall dead, and we can introduce fret buzz. We don't want any of that, so it's a delicate play between playability and a good sound. If you want to go the easy route, we can just see if lowering the saddles will fix everything and we're back to shredding in no time. So we're measuring the gap at fret 12, or a method that's generally a little bit better. We put a capo on fret 1 and we measure the gap at fret 17. This way we eliminate the nut height of the guitar so we get a more accurate read. Generally, both measurements will give you the same results. So the following is very personal, but I like my action on the 6th string, the thickest, to be around 1.5 millimeters. And for the high string goes around 1 millimeter. On the left we see the measurements in millimeters, the metric system, on the right the imperial system in inches. But I gotta admit, I never measure the action at all. You should always strive for getting a good playing guitar and not try hitting a number. But if you're new to measuring or setting up the action, it may be a very good indication of getting in the right ballpark. So usually you will see higher values recommended, so don't take this as an advice, but getting a guitar that plays like butter often makes it sound like butter too, but feel free to go a little bit higher if that feels right for you. Anyway, I'm lowering the saddles of the bridge with this Allen wrench. Don't overdo it, try half a turn at first. On this guitar we can adjust every single string, so I'm gonna do that right now. And I've got some more experience with this, so I'm just doing a whole turn from the get-go and see how that sounds. Always remember how much you turn so you can go back to the original position you started from if everything goes south. That goes for every adjustment we make in this video. Always write it down how much you change so you can always go back. So a whole turn on every screw. Depending on the kind of bridge, it can look different. On the Gibson Tunematic bridge, you only get 2 adjusting points. I now lowered the action, retuned the guitar. I think the action is a little bit too low for my own preference, actually. But still, no dead spots. That's how I check, just play the chromatic scale everywhere. And I suggest always checking for buzz with an amp. A little bit of buzz without an amp isn't that bad. If it's not amplified, you won't hear it playing on an amp. See? So now I'm measuring just below 1.5 millimeters on the 6th string, the thick, the low E string. And around 1 millimeter on the high E. I'm happy with this. I may do some refinement off camera, but I'm very close to how I like it. For acoustic guitars, it's a little different. For this Atkin acoustic, I'm measuring an action of just above 3 millimeters. And you guessed it, that's too high for me. So I'm carefully taking out the saddle of the bridge and going to sand it down twice the amount I want the action to be lowered. So I'm taking off around 1.5 millimeters of the saddle. You can use a file or sandpaper or both and make sure to check in between. I'm happy. I'm finishing it off with the finest sandpaper I've got and place it back. Let's see. That's 2.5 millimeters. Perfect. But this isn't always how it goes though. Sometimes you find that the slots in the nut aren't filed down deep enough. Especially on the lower end guitars, this happens a lot. This makes playing in the lower register very hard because the strings are so far apart from the frets. The only solution for this is get a set of slot files and file them down till it feels great. But be careful because you can't go back easily. You can with some glue and some residue, but it's very hard. And also you gotta have the right movement and the right angle. So it's a tricky thing. You might wanna see a luthier for this. Anyway, but sometimes when you think everything is right, you still can't get the action low enough without introducing dead notes or fret buzz. And this is the time we take a look at the neck. And now we're off to guitar number 2, because that guitar has that issue. Let's get the Gibson SG. So when I took this Gibson home, I changed the strings. And after doing so, a few notes fell dead on the lower part of the neck. You see? Over here is good. But over here. Okay. Some might be very scared of seeing a guitar like this, and actually it hurts my heart a little bit too. The neck was almost perfectly straight. That's the way the guitar tech from that shop had it set up. And I guess the new strings had a different kind of tension on the neck, and that causes this issue. So let's get to it. If you're as fond as guitar bending as I am, you know that the string pull of just one string can be pretty high already. But just imagine putting all those strings on the neck, all trying to bend the neck forward. And you can imagine putting heavier strings or thinner strings on heavily impacts that tension on the neck. So now let's introduce the truss rod. It's a rod running in the neck that we can adjust so we can get the neck in the perfect position. So what is perfect? Well, the neck can basically be in 3 states. It can be perfectly straight, which is tricky to get right, but isn't necessarily bad. It is how this guitar was set up. A back bow, which is always bad, and an up bow. And this is what we want, a real minimal up bow, so the string can ring freely when it's fretted on the neck. When the guitar is tuned up, a string is always perfectly straight. So when the neck has a slight up bow, there should be a little bit free play between the string and the frets in the middle. So let's put a capo on fret 1 again. So it's not only made for Wonderwall, also for guitar teching. If I now fret the fret at the highest point where the neck meets the body, the string is perfectly straight. Now in the middle, there should be free play. And a good way to check that is just hitting the string. You should hear a clacky sound because the string flicking on the neck. You see, there's no sound at all. The string is now lying flat on the frets, meaning the guitar is having a back bow. Luckily, we can easily fix this, but we gotta keep our mind at it. So imagine that the strings are trying to pull the neck this way, right? And by fastening the rod, we pull the neck the other way around. So by loosening the truss rod, we give in to the strings, so the neck becomes more an up bow. And by fastening the truss rod, we counter the string pull the other way around. So if you just think about it like that, it's easy to remember. So right, we create more of a back bow, left, we create more of an up bow. So the truss rod on this SG is tightened too fast since there is a back bow. So righty-tighty, lefty-loosey again. Let's turn this one left. And always do it with small increments. 1/4. Opa. Retune the guitar, see if we fix some of the issues. Wow. Wow. So the problem is almost entirely gone now. Amazing. There's a little bit of buzz still. Maybe you can hear it without a guitar. So I'm giving it 1/8 of a turn. And that should be it. Final check. Beautiful. You see how such a small turn does so much to the guitar. That's it. So on your guitar, the truss rod may be adjusted with an Allen wrench. Always be a little bit careful when adjusting the truss rod. If it doesn't move or there's too much friction, don't overdo it, don't over-tighten it, because it can damage the guitar. It always should feel very natural and should move easily. So we can also measure the gap with feeler gauges, but that's not as easy as it sounds. I prefer the tap test. So let's see if there is a gap right now. Ah, yes. Do you hear the tapping sound? So that means there is a gap between the string and the neck. Let's do it over here. Yeah, there's two. So we fixed the neck. Awesome. So if there's too much of an oboe, so too much space in between the strings, frets can buzz at the higher registers. So we need to fasten the truss rod a little bit more to see if the neck comes down a little bit. So if you fix the neck, it's time to get back to the action and see if there are some things we can do. It's always a play between the neck and the action, you know, to get it all right. Anyway, let's move on to another adjustment that makes all the difference. And let's do that on the Strat, because I was noticing some serious issues. And I'm talking about the intonation. So this is basically that the pitch of every note is the pitch that it should be. Sounds logical, right? But it's not always that easy. So if you hit that high note and it sounds a little bit too sharp, or you play a chord higher up the neck and it sounds like out of tune, that's probably an intonation issue. There's literally nothing more annoying. So how do we fix that? So at the bridge of the guitar, we see these saddles and they are movable. And by doing so, we make the string longer or shorter. And basically what we do is make sure that fret 12 is exactly in the middle of the string. So smack a new set of strings on there so we can get clear measurements, tune it up and play fret 12. Fret and play it gently, just like you're about to hit the like button, right? And now play the harmonic too. So we play a note, we fret it, fret 12, gently. Now we play the harmonic. So it should be identical in pitch. And if you don't trust your ears, just use a tuner. So I'm hearing the fretted note is too low. We go up in pitch when you play the harmonic. So the string is too long right now, because the longer the string, the lower the note. The shorter the string, the higher the note. So what we need to do to make the fretted note a little bit higher is move the saddle that way. Very easy, and this may look different depending on the kind of bridge you've got. I suggest lowering the string a little bit so the saddle has more free play to move, and just turn it so that the saddle moves towards the headstock. Just do it with small increments. Tune up again, and let's see if we're more in the ballpark. That's pretty close. Maybe it's a little bit too low still. So you see, check, readjust, check again, till you're spot on, and now we do so for every string. And now your guitar will sound in tune, no matter where you play on the neck. High and low. More or less. It's still a guitar. Anyway, so the following is something that I discovered a while ago. It's the pickup height, number 4. So many pickups just sound so much better when they are a bit lower than usually prescribed. And that includes factory setup too. And maybe it has to do with the fact that volume generally impresses more than an actual good tone. So if you're comparing two guitars in the store and the one sounds louder, you automatically think that will sound better. But let's do the test with the Gibson ES-335, since I didn't change those pickups yet. I saw that these were fairly high at the moment, much closer to the strings than my Les Paul, for example. So let's see what happens when we adjust them. So adjusting pickups is super easy. Each pickup has 2 screws, and just turn them down. And always remember how many turns you did. So I'm lowering them by 4 whole turns. And I recorded this guitar earlier, so let's see how it compares. the pickups significantly, and I gotta say, the pickup sounded nicer, a little less spiky and more balanced. Also, these magnets negatively impact the strings, the vibrating of the strings. So the less that happens, the better. Just remember the position you started from as always, so you can always bring it back up, but lower it till it starts to sound thin, and then bring it up a notch, and you're set. What comes out may shock you, so really try it yourself as well. Leave in the comments what your experiences are with that. So next up, and that's maybe the most important of all, the day-to-day. Number one, fastening the bolts. Super important. When I was still teaching, you wouldn't believe the amounts of loose washers, bolts and screws I saw. And by itself, it isn't too much of a problem, but it can eventually turn into way bigger problems. So here's a few things to regularly check and avoid. Number one, the strap button. So if these become loose, they will start to wiggle. And the small wiggle will turn into a bigger wiggle, until eventually it will literally fall out of the guitar, meaning your instrument is on the floor and the strap is hanging over your neck. And we don't want that, right? And another classic, the output jack, or the output is loose and wiggles. Not too much of a deal, you say, until the solder joints will become loose because all of that wiggling and your signal is gone. And if I learned one thing is that that happens the minute you step on that stage. Next up, loose washers and screws on the tuners. And this can cause major tuning instability. Check them and make sure to not over-tighten these. Be careful. Other than that, there's cleaning the fretboard. Definitely not my favorite thing, but this is what I use. I've got bottles of random sprays and oils. This one is very good. The magic potion. I have no idea what's in it, but I got it from my luthier. From Higher Guitar, shout out. So just do it whenever you change the strings. Rub some oil in and just rub away the excess dirt. Do it gently, don't damage the woods. I use a microfiber cloth for this. Dirty. And use some general guitar care bottles that will treat your guitar. If you take care of your guitars as gently as you're about to hit that like button, we're all set. Leave your top guitar care tips in the comments or share your thoughts about whatever you want down below. And maybe this is a good time to say how much I appreciate this community we've been building over the past few years. We're closing in on 2 million and it's just amazing. Thank you so much. Catch you guys in the next one.